This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream and Nebula.
Hey everybody, so a few weeks ago now, I encountered one of the strangest tweets I have ever seen in my life. On June 7th, 2021, ShoeOnHead, an online influencer, said this. F***ing animals is bad. Globe emoji, sock emoji, rose emoji. Source? Looking at this tweet, on first pass, it is almost incomprehensible, right? Like, what happened here? Shu was just hanging out online, talking about how animal sex is bad, as one does, and then a bunch of globalists, social democrats, and socialists, that's what those emojis mean, all started hounding her for a source for that claim? What? How did any of that happen? What is this tweet doing? And how exactly did it come to be? Well, naturally, I decided to look into it, and what I found was, I think, a pretty fascinating story. A story about the strangeness of Twitter discourse, about how we treat each other online, about ethics and moral thinking. Today, I'm gonna take you through the experience that I had, and I hope that'll be an interesting time for you. Two disclaimers. One. This video is not about canceling ShoeOnHead. I know she's a controversial figure online, and we will talk about her a bit later on, but if you're looking forward to some big, important takedown, you're not gonna get what you want. Two, as you might have guessed, I'm gonna be talking for a little while about bestiality. It's not what this video is about, there's nothing graphic here, and I don't think I say anything particularly controversial, but just know what you're getting into. And with that, let's get into it. Our story begins with a humble Twitter user named Delaniac making the following tweet. Alright, time to capitalize on the vegan discourse for engagement. Absent extenuating considerations, survival, cost, health conditions, is killing an animal for meat morally different than bestiality? Please explain your reasoning below. Now, I'm gonna tip my hand here and say that yes, I do think there is a distinction to be made between these two acts. But that doesn't mean this isn't a good question or that its answer is obvious. In fact, I'd say that thinking through it is pretty complicated. And since that's very relevant here, let's explore the question together. I think most of us probably come into this question with the moral intuition that bestiality is clearly worse than animal eating. I know I do. But when you try to figure out exactly why that is, you immediately hit a roadblock. For one thing, killing an animal to harvest its meat seems to be very harmful to the animal. And just instinctively, I would say I don't really know how to measure that harm against the harm of animal sex. But to make matters worse, to make this question even harder, we have to acknowledge the current conditions of factory farming. Under this system, farmhands are regularly paid to, you know, use their hands to inseminate cows. The point is that in either the case of bestiality or the case of meat production, non-consensual sexual acts are performed on animals. And yet, the former act is broadly understood to be deviant, repulsive, and immoral, and the latter act is broadly understood to be lunch. So, why do we make this distinction? Well, I think this is a decent starting point. The difference between bestiality and burger eating has nothing to do with the harm caused to animals and everything to do with the characteristics of the person who does those things. In the case of burger eating, while it is obvious and uncontroversial to say that this does harm to animals, it's a kind of instrumental harm. Burger Boy doesn't derive pleasure specifically from the anguish of the cow. No, he's not thinking about it at all. What he wants is beef, not the suffering of the cow. But the person who commits a bestial act is exacting pleasure specifically from a situation that causes harm. Dogs do not want to have sex with people. I think that's fairly obvious. And so, to have that sex is to take joy from the invasion of boundaries, the skirting of consent. Why then might bestiality be worse than meat eating? I'd say it's because bestiality says something very ugly and very dark about the person who does it. To be clear, this doesn't excuse any action, doesn't mean either of these things are morally acceptable, but I do think there's some difference here. What I just said was very contentious, I know that. A hard-lining consequentialist might immediately respond, "Who cares about motive, Big Joel? All that matters is the effect that an action has. Everything else is just nonsense." Now, I could say a lot of things to that consequentialist, but if I engaged in that conversation, this video would truly take forever. I'm happy that people might disagree with me on this because my point is just that the question is complicated. That it gets at the very center of how morality works, how we should treat our moral intuitions, and why. And now, it's time for us to explore how this question, strange as it is, got explored on Twitter.com. I debated whether or not to properly introduce Shuanhead in this video. Information about her isn't particularly important to the point I'm trying to make, so part of me thought, why bother? But she is pretty dang famous online, so I figured I'd give a bit of info to the totally uninitiated. Shuanhead began her career as an anti-feminist, anti-SJW gamergator. Her career revolved around finding some snowflake online and roasting them hardcore with facts and logic. That is, until roughly 2016, when two major things happened. First, Donald Trump was elected president and it shocked a lot of people. Second, Bernie Sanders became a household name, and with him came a renewed mainstream interest in socialism. After this, feminism slowly crept into the background of online discourse, and Shuanhead changed gears, in a good way. She was always a liberal, and she started emphasizing her support for leftist policies and Bernie Sanders more than her hatred for feminism and SJWs. A lot of people seem very concerned with the question, has Shuanhead changed? And I can't tell you the answer to that. She's a person. I'm sure her perspectives have evolved somewhat, but it's hard to say how specifically. Does she still think feminism is dumb as hell? Does she still think fatphobia is just made-up BuzzFeed nonsense? Does she still think women are biologically determined to be less funny than our men? I don't know, and I, like, barely care at this point. Anyhow, that's enough context. This is how Shuanhead first responded to that question about eating meat and bestiality. We are natural meat eaters. We are not natural animal fuckers. We bang our own species. There is no reason to bang animals except for being some kind of hedonistic freak. Now, look, whatever you think of my account of the moral difference between these two acts, what Shu says here is a very bad answer. And that's for two fairly obvious reasons. First, the word natural has no coherent definition. That's not to say it's a bad word or that it has no uses, but it is imprecise and generally seems to refer to a random set of associations that people have. Second, and more importantly, even if we did have some coherent definition for natural, there'd still be no reason to think that what is natural must also be good. It seems intuitive to me to say that murder, which has been around since the beginning of humanity, is natural, and that eating an airhead, this synthetic processed treat, is unnatural. But I think I'm right when I say that murder is bad and airheads are delicious. Here's the thing. Shuanhead's argument here isn't just bad, it is iconically bad. It is the bad argument. Every debate nerd on this planet knows about the naturalistic fallacy. What's more, appealing to natural behaviors is famous because it is the go-to argument of bigots and social conservatives. Social Darwinism, homophobia, and racism have all been defended with claims about what is and isn't natural. I'm not saying that Shu believes in any of those things. I don't think that at all, but it's a bad argument with a bad track record, and it's easy as shit to call it out. And so, people did. Of course they did. The wheels of Twitter turned. If it was natural to eat people, would you think it's morally okay to do so? As pointed out, this is a fallacy of appealing to nature. Appeal to nature. Who would have thought that Shu would make eighth grader level argument. Now, I could go on and on with this. I have not scratched the surface of people angrily and accurately informing Shu that her argument was bad. To be clear, I don't think this was cancel culture or bullying or whatever, but this kind of thing can absolutely make a person feel defensive, make them feel like they have to vindicate themselves. I can't read Shu's mind, but perhaps this is why the situation kind of escalated right here. When Delaniac essentially claimed her argument was based on emotion, she responded, "Let me just bust out my fucking data sheet explaining why fucking a horse is bad." And then, 30 minutes later, it seemed this was not enough, and in a standalone tweet to her large audience, she wrote the tweet that we've already seen. "Fucking animals is bad, globe emoji, sock emoji, rose emoji, source? So now that we're seeing this tweet in its full context, I think there's a lot that just feels wrong here, right? First off, she started it. She was the one who decided to engage with this discourse. She didn't just say having sex with animals is bad. No, she made a whole little argument there. Yet now she decided that engaging with this question is on its face stupid and ridiculous. That's puzzling. But maybe more importantly, this was never an argument about whether or not bestiality is good. You can see that, right? Delaniac later says in this thread that he's a vegan. This question is obviously meant to get you thinking about if eating meat is bad, not if having sex with animals is good. But Shu just eliminates that part, omits it entirely from her account. Again, puzzling. So what's going on here? Well, here's what I'd say. Shu is crafting her tweet around the desire to make this discourse seem as silly and obvious as possible. First, she performatively extricates herself from the conversation, pretends she wasn't engaged with it in the first place, and in doing so, imagines herself as a hapless, normal person who simply found herself involved with this awful conversation. Then she removes the context. No longer was this about veganism and how we evaluate moral transgression. Suddenly, it's just, should I get sex with horses? A pretty trivially easy question for most people to answer. And although it might not look it, this process of performing a discourse in a way that makes it seem absurd or nonsensical is extremely powerful in a rhetorical sense. Because in this moment, she is able to implicitly ask a question. If this so-called ethical quandary was this easy for me to resolve, if it took none of my mental faculties, then what kind of weird-ass, vaguely suspicious person is getting stumped by this? This is what Shu means with the second half of her tweet, right? Look at all these terminally online socialists and social democrats and globalists, people who inexplicably want me to provide a source or data sheet to substantiate my beliefs. This is an impossible standard they are deploying to obfuscate the readily apparent fact that animal sex is bad. And see, it doesn't matter here what she originally said, the part she played in all this. It doesn't matter that none of them were actually asking for a source or data sheet, because that's simply not how moral philosophy works. It doesn't matter that this is not the point that anyone was making, because now these people are just weirdos. They are perverting our discourse, justifying for no apparent reason the needless harming of animals. It's important to note the role this tweet plays within a larger online context, because it's something we find a lot, specifically on Twitter. Before this point, what was happening was a conversation. Someone said something, Shu made a point, people objected to it, and she got mad. There was a give and take, there were people in genuine conflict. But now, with this tweet, all that is gone, and what we're left with is this odd performance, this presentation of values and ideas and politics that is directed not to any person, but to the public. And this becomes clear with the final tweet that Shu made on this subject. You can see the tweet here, but what I'm more invested in is the responses that it got. Debate culture and its consequences have been a disaster for the left. Combos like that tell me there are some sick people in the world. If I was in a face-to-face conversation and had to tell somebody why they shouldn't do that to a horse, I'd just leave and then tell people that person wants to fuck a horse. How is bestiality as bad controversial? Why would one need to even elaborate on that? Maybe letting everyone have an opinion was a bad idea. Free speech was a mistake. Imagine being publicly this passionate about horse fucking. I may not agree with you politically, but I swear you have some of the weirdest people that post on your threads, and I thank you for opening my eyes to how fucked up some people in this country really are. Shu is the good guy, the reasonable, common sense figure. And in order to sustain that narrative, a harmful political other needs to be invented. There is something inherently wrong here, and Shu, in her own small way, is setting it right. I started this video by disclaiming that this story was not about canceling or calling out Shu on head, and I hope you see just how much I mean that. For one thing, all this is small beans. A few tweets that didn't go anywhere, an online drama that didn't add up to much. Hardly a reason to hate anybody. But also, when I look at Shu's actions here, I am deeply empathetic. Again, I am not a mind reader or a psychologist, but I can so easily imagine being in her shoes. Somebody asked a question. How is meat eating different from animal sex? Shu, I'm guessing, eats meat and has the strong desire to not have her actions be seen as similar to those of a horse fucker. I eat meat too, though I have been trying to reduce that since writing this video, and I totally understand where she's coming from there. So, she tries to make an argument. What if one of these actions is natural and the other is unnatural? But then, everybody just kinda gets mad at her, tells her that she's not making sense. But what if she didn't have an other argument? What if this appeal to naturalness was the only thing she knew how to offer? And suddenly, she has a problem. If this is the one argument she can make, and if it's a bad one, then maybe she's wrong. Maybe she has no good reason to distinguish between her actions and those of a horse fucker. Jesus, that is a hard pill to even think about swallowing, right? So what does she do to avoid this uncomfortable line of thought? Well, as we've seen, she weaponizes that discomfort, makes a show of it. Why are you people talking about this? Why are you doing this silly thought experiment in the first place? You people are producing weird bestiality apologia, and if you can't see why that's not okay, that's your problem. Through this paradoxical logic, the fact that she couldn't assemble a thoughtful position becomes evidence of her moral virtue. Because unlike these freaks, she doesn't even have to think to know that she's right. She doesn't need a good argument. She already knows the truth. So, no, this video isn't about shaming Shuonhead or pretending this event was some big deal when it wasn't. Actually, it's much worse than that. Because we can see here, in this mundane, random little moment, just how much we will do to avoid being challenged, how correct and virtuous we can look while doing so, and how fast we will find ourselves defaulting to this position. We want to be pure, follow our intuitions, believe that we are fundamentally good. And so, the people who might disrupt our ability to do that must be impure, must be wrong. This is how a question becomes a contaminant, how critical thinking becomes a disease that needs to be stamped out. Because in a lot of cases, it is genuinely easier to perform incredulity, to invent some harm, to produce a political other, than to just think about something for a while.
Oh my god, I feel myself shifting and changing. I think I'm about to enter my human form. Wow, I'm real. Did you like that video? Did it leave you desperately craving and yearning for even more of my content? Well, if so, the streaming service Nebula is for you. Every month for the foreseeable future, I'll be releasing a special video on there. So right now there's a bunch of videos, it's really adding up. There's one about Shane Dawson's 9/11 trutherism, one about the movie About Time, and this month I made a secret video. It's about a conspiracy theory I saw on Twitter, but the tweet in question only has 12 likes, so I didn't want to blast the person on a big platform. These vids can be released to the public after a long time, usually like a year, but most of them probably won't be, and especially not this new one, because I don't even feel comfortable showing you the tweet that it's about. I love making these videos. It's become such a fun creative break every month, and so I hope you like them too. The whole thing is frankly epic. With a subscription to CuriosityStream where you can watch nature documentaries like this David Attenborough one about ants, I like the ants one. You also get access to Nebula, where you get my videos early, those bonus ones I talked about, and access to tons of other stuff. Bonus videos from Lindsay Ellis, Sarah Z, Tom Scott, and even more than that, probably. For $15 for the whole year, you get the whole thing, which I think is a pretty good deal. Anyhow, if you're interested in any of that, sign up now with the link in my description, curiositystream.com/bigjoel. So that's it. That's the video. I know this one was kind of weird, but I enjoyed making it, and I hope you liked it. And if you did, I invite you to like, comment, subscribe, you know, give me money on Patreon if you want to.
Just so you know, all the videos I make for Nebula are also accessible through Patreon. I didn't want to make anyone giving me money feel ripped off or whatever. And now it's time for my Patreon question of the video. Henry R. Seymour asks, is there a correct way to consume artwork? Is criticism of artwork valid if you don't consume it in the intended way? To the first question, I don't necessarily think there is a correct way of consuming artwork, but I do think there are correct ways of interpreting it. And what I mean by that is that there are clearly incorrect ways of interpreting artwork, right? Say you're looking at a novel or a painting and you make up some feature that it has to fit within the narrative you want to tell about the painting. Well, in that case, you are misinterpreting the bit of art. You are lying about it and doing a bad job. So there may be an infinite number of ways to interpret texts properly, but there are ways to misinterpret them too. So the second question, is criticism of artwork valid if you don't consume it in the intended way? Yeah, of course it's valid. We don't even know what the intended way to consume art is. There's no way of divining that fact. And in many cases, accessing it is literally impossible. So, you know, of course it's valid to not look at authorial intent, in my opinion at least. Anyhow, thanks for watching my video. Also, Moth Cub Lily did a wonderful job animating. Go follow her on Instagram and Twitter and YouTube and all that stuff. Okay, bye.